Welcome to This Week in Leadership Research, episode number 4. Each week, I share a recently published journal article on leadership research. My goal is to translate the most up-to-date leadership research to leadership practices that help you in your daily work. This week, I'll try to answer two questions. First, what is intuitive decision-making? Second, how does an individual decision maker's intuition unfold in a team, particularly in a top management team? Those are the questions posed in an article titled "The Forms and Use of Intuition in Top Management Teams." The article was published in the Leadership Quarterly 2022. The link of the article is in the description section below. Let's first look at intuitive decision making. It is defined as affectively charged judgments that arise through rapid, unconscious, and holistic association. Of course, this is not the only definition of intuition. Other definitions include thoughts and preferences that come to mind quickly and without much reflection. A non-conscious holistic processing mode in which judgments are made with no awareness of the rules of knowledge used for inference, which can feel right despite one's inability to articulate the reason. The subjective experience of a mostly non-conscious process, fast, illogical, and inaccessible to consciousness, that depending on exposure to the domain or problem space, is capable of accurately extracting probabilistic contingencies. Intuitive decision-making is different from rational analytical decision-making. When we make rational decisions, we consciously create a choice set, which is a group of options, evaluate potential utility, value, outcomes of each option, and choose an option that maximizes the utility. The entire process is logical and analytical. Intuitive decision-making has at least three features. First, intuitive decision-making process is unconscious. We are unaware that our brains have already processed information and reached a decision. In my book on leaders' decision-making, I introduced introspection illusion. Introspection involves looking inward into conscious thoughts, feelings, motives, and intentions. An introspection illusion is a strong sense that we can directly access the processes underlying our mental states. Most mental processes, however, are largely unavailable for our conscious interpretation. The processing capacity of our conscious mind has been estimated at 120 bits per second. That bandwidth is the speed limit for traffic of information we can pay conscious attention to at any time. For something to become encoded as part of our experience, we need to pay conscious attention to it. But there is a great deal of information processing that occurs below the threshold of our awareness. The catch is that we are unaware of our unawareness. Therefore, even though introspection feels as if we are simply observing our inner intentions, it is largely an inference about our inner intentions rather than a true reflection of them. Moreover, we have unique access to our own but not others' introspections. We tend to overvalue our own introspection, leading to another source of an introspection illusion. Much of the work of our brain is done at an unconscious level. A decision can be predicted before we consciously make a decision. The gut-feeling decision-making process is fast and subconscious, enabling us to make decisions without an extensive search for information, evidence, or data. More intriguingly, when we are asked to explain our decisions, our brain generates post-hoc explanations, which are all based on what makes it into our consciousness, But the reality is the actions and the feelings happen before we are consciously aware of them. And most of them are the results of non-conscious process, which will never make it into the explanations. Conscious rationalization allows access to only certain information that makes into our consciousness. In human brains, the subliminal state, however, is the most robust part of the consciousness network. No matter how hard you try, some mental and emotional processes are likely to remain below the threshold of your consciousness. The second feature of intuitive decision-making process is that it's very fast. This creates a trade-off between decision-making quality and decision speed. Making fast judgment calls, we run the risk of making decisions with compromised quality. Intuition serves as well because it allows us to make decisions efficiently without painstakingly analyzing all information constantly. But intuition can go wrong sometimes when the fast information processing goes awry. The third feature of intuitive decision-making process is that it is affectively charged. Affect is an umbrella term for feelings, emotions, mood, and emotion-related traits. Feelings are internal subjective states that are known only to those who have them, whereas emotions are bodily and mental states that manifest through behavior. Emotions, therefore, are detectable and can be observed through facial expression, for example, smiling when you are happy, and body language, for example, slamming the door when you are angry, vocal tones, for example, trembling voice when you are afraid, and skin color, for example, blush when you are attracted to someone. Mood is a temporary state of mind or feeling. A moody person does not stay in one mood for a long time. The mood swings. Affect influences your decision-making in a predictable way. Gratitude, empathy, and awe make you altruistic and want to be helpful toward those who are around you. Some emotions, such as fear and pride, narrow your attention span, giving you tunnel vision. As a result, you stick to an option about which you know more rather than searching for options about which you have less information, such as seeking and taking others' advice. By contrast, other emotions, such as gratitude and shame, broaden your attention span, enabling you to explore options through advice-seeking behavior. Since emotions are sometimes instrumental in making wise decisions, the old saying, "Don't allow emotions to cloud your judgment," is sometimes wrong. Neuroscientists have identified a link between intuition and affect through activation of basal ganglia in the human brain. The basal ganglia are a group of brain structures near the center of our brain. They interact with other parts of our brains and collectively control our body's ability to move and emotional processing. The basal ganglia also process signals that influence our emotions and motivation, and process how we evaluate goals and risks. The article I introduced this week actually focused more on intuition in a team. The authors provided many definitions of team intuition. Some scholars argue that team intuition is not a simple aggregation of individual team members' intuition. Instead, it may have an emergent property, which means the whole is different from the sum. Team intuition can be categorically different from individual team members' intuition. Researchers characterize team intuition into four types by two dimensions: locus of intuition and integration of intuition. The locus of intuition refers to whether the intuition originates from a top manager or from the top management team. The integration of intuition refers to the extent to which an individual's psychological contents are integrated into team intuition. Psychological contents are defined as manager's factual knowledge, beliefs about cause-effect relationships, and the sensitivities to the relevance of issues, as well as their subconscious goals and implicit attitude and stereotypes. On the lower left, there is dominant actor intuition. As the name suggests, an individual dominates the team. In this case, that individual's intuition is team intuition. The source of team intuition comes from one individual. Other team members' intuition is not integrated into the team intuition. An example provided by the researchers was former Apple chairman and CEO Steve Jobs. Although the top management team members were talented, but Steve Jobs relied solely on his own intuitions to decide what products to offer in the market. The benefit of dominant actor intuition is a high decision-making speed. No need to have endless meetings and deliberations because one person makes a judgment call. But there are at least two downsides. First, when an entire team is held accountable for the consequences of decisions, but only one individual makes a judgment call, it creates a procedural injustice, which refers to unfair procedures. Another downside of dominant actor intuition is that other team members' expertise and knowledge are wasted, which may compromise decision quality. Is this type of team intuition common? According to Hambrick, who studied what it meant to be a team, many top management teams actually had very little teamness. This is because top management teams are often unstructured collections of high achievers who expect autonomy and direction in heading up their own subdivisions. Top managers typically resent mandates for lateral collaborations. Their interactions are infrequent and ritualistic. As a result, CEOs are forced to function as a hub of the top management teams, gathering scattered information to make decisions. On the upper left, there is shared intuition. It refers to team members that have the same or similar intuition. It happens when there is not much cognitive diversity and a lot of groupthink. In the top management team, all members think alike, and they affirm each other's intuition. In this case, one for all and all for one. The benefit of shared intuition is, again, decision speed. The downside is a failure to explore different options. On the lower right, there is actor-driven collective intuition. The team intuition is driven by one team member. It doesn't have to be the same dominant actor in all decisions. The source of intuition can change based on task, situational or interpersonal requirements. The top management team is structurally interdependent. Team members' roles are arranged in a way that they depend on one another. So in team decision-making, all team members need to agree upon those decisions. One team member's intuition is validated or adjusted through input and verification from other team members. The collective team intuition is a product of all team members' intuition, which originates from one team member's intuition. The benefit of actor-driven collective intuition is that the team intuition is a modified version of one individual's intuition after the team's joint activities in information exchange. The downside is that the decision speed is slowed down due to the team's joint activities. On the upper right, there is team-driven collective intuition. It is the product of all top management team members interacting and sharing different ideas, opinions, and perspectives. The source of team intuition is joint activities of the top management team and different team members' diverse intuition is highly integrated. What are the conditions of team-driven collective intuition? Team members' frank conversations and expression of diverse views are required. No one team member can take credit for the team intuition or even clearly state his or her contributions to the collective intuition. Here, the team intuition has an emergent property because it is not a simple aggregation of individual team members' intuition. How to apply the findings in this article to leadership practices that can help us in our daily work? In collective decision-making settings, such as making a decision as a board or a committee, we focus on two things. First, who should be entrusted with decision-making power? Each team member's intuition should be a source of team intuition. Each team member should have sufficient psychological contents, which means actual knowledge, beliefs of causal-effect relationships, and sensitivities to the relevance of issues. We also need to be aware of team members' subconscious goals and implicit attitudes and stereotypes. Second, structure and process of information exchange among team members. This is probably the most challenging part to move beyond the individual tuition to generate collective team intuition. How to motivate team members to share their psychological content? How to facilitate frank conversations? How to integrate diverse intuition from different team members? Those are questions for you to explore in your leadership research and leadership practices. If you are a researcher, I hope the article I introduced today can offer some inspirations for your research. If you are a leader or aspire to be a leader, I hope the articles can guide you in your leadership practices. Stay open-minded, get inspired, and never stop improving your leadership skills. I'll see you next week in This Week in Leadership Research.